Holy shit, am I excited today, Biscuit Babies. Finally, after starting the show in 2016, I have a Columbus Blue Jacket coming on. As the regular listeners know, I am a Blue Jacket fan, have been my entire life since they announced that they would be a team in 1997. And today's guest was a member of the OG original 2000 team coming over in the expansion draft. I'm very, very excited to have Jean-Luc Grand-Pierre on today. Before we get into the episode, though, I got a few sponsors I want to talk about who helped this show happen. First off is Hairless Ape Conspiracies. What does it mean to be a hairless ape? Well, it's more than just a t-shirt, even though their t-shirts are the best t-shirt I've ever worn with a catchphrase. It's a way of looking at the world, a way of seeing failure as an opportunity to improve past our one-time best, seeing hardship and tragedy as lessons taught in pain, sweat, and blood, viewing our small community as our tribe, and our tribalism as something to be professed and propagated, a way of seeing mortal life as a challenge to be bested, to be competed against, holding nothing back, seeing our inner and outer strengths as our faith and depending on ourselves and our skills to be the things we count on when the challenge of life seems to be winning. Our unique perspective is that we need to get back to the natural order of things. Strengthen our bodies with hard work. Strengthen our minds by seeking and gaining knowledge, which you are doing right now by listening to The Biscuit, of course, wherever you may find it. And attacking our passions and our lives with the true strengths. Knowing we only live each day, we are present in the moment, and we find ways to make the most of every day. We fight hard, we love harder, and we don't stop until they throw dirt upon us. Hairless Ape Conspiracy. Better known, better not operated. If you want to know more about the company, go back and listen to the episode with Sam Burns. It was around 115, maybe 110 episode. Truly an amazing guy. Couldn't be happier than to work with Hairless Ape. And they absolutely make the best t-shirt I've ever worn. Use promo code BISCUIT10 at checkout. Save yourself 10% off. That's at hairlessapeinc.com. And they've got stuff that's sold out right now, guys. He's working his butt off. They're going to get it all back in stock, and then the new line will be dropping soon, too. Why don't you drop your line into Lucid Float Spas in Mount Vernon, Ohio. Get in that sensory deprivation tank. I think they're moving to a new home. I'm not 100% sure. I'll let you guys know. I'll talk to Chad, the owner. But go there. Tell Chad The Biscuit sent you. Save half off your first float. That's a savings of over $30. You're welcome. And as always, brought to you by ParkersPlatoon.org, Scott Parker, the sheriff, Stanley Cup champion, his wife, and their son, DJ Parker, have a nonprofit organization to help one veteran at a time. Make sure to go visit ParkersPlatoon.org to see how you can help today. And Scott Parker's also teamed up with Riley Cote, both former guests of The Biscuit, and they have a CBD company called Body Check Wellness. And go check that out. If you're not doing CBD, I don't know what the fuck you're doing. And again, guys, today's guest, Jean-Luc Grand-Pierre. Very excited. Enjoy.
Now, he's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nyland, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt.
It's old time hockey.
Enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's The Biscuit. It's The Biscuit.
Damn it! Set goal regulation size of what?
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. As a country will stop working on some Batman's fucking can.
Hi, everybody. It's The Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, wanna go? Yeah, okay. Good luck, man.
All right, Biscuit Babies. I've got the Hyphenator on the line. Jean-Luc Grand-Pierre, how you doing, bud?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm doing really good, man. I'm excited to have you on. Like I was saying before the show, I've been a Blue Jacket fan my whole life. I've been doing the podcast for a little over 2 years now, and you're the first Blue Jacket on, so this is a truly an honor.
Nice, and you're in Ohio as well, right?
Yes, sir. About an hour north, up 71 from you.
It took you that long. I'm honored to be the first one.
I think I was afraid to ask you guys. I'd be like, God, they don't want to talk to me.
yeah, we don't bark. we don't bite.
The only other one I've ever spoke to is Jody Shelley, and that was at a practice, and I just kind of, like, wandered up and was like, hey, man, I'm a big fan. And he was just like, oh, okay, guy.
I'm surprised. Jody's such a nice guy.
No, he was really nice. I was really weird. I was, like, I was nervous, and I was, it wasn't his fault. He was super nice. I was being weird.
So you're the one that came out. You came out as a creep. So
exactly. I'm sure he had dinner that night. He's like, man, this big creep came up to me like acting like a 6-year-old. I'm like, hey, mister.
That's when guys typically call security right there.
Yeah, exactly. Who's this big bearded tattooed creep talking to me? Well, so you just got back from Europe, man. Were you over there doing some tryouts or what?
No crowds for me. Just we actually went over to visit some friends while I was playing overseas, we became pretty close with, and their son actually came to Ohio, went to Walsh University, but he was staying with us for the past 4 years in Columbus. So him and my daughter went to school together in Germany. So now, like, he's kind of like family. So I call him my second adopted son. And we just went out to Germany to visit him, and then did a lot of sightseeing again while we're there. So
absolutely, is that one of the better parts of playing overseas? Is making connections like that, where you can look back on it after retiring and be like, "Oh, I've got friends in Germany, I've got friends in Sweden, all kinds of neat places."
Yeah, it really is. Overall, I would say, especially so for me, because I did have kids. My son was only like 2 years old when I went over, and now he's 14. So, but the cool thing was, the pace of games over there, you're not playing as many games, obviously, as North America. So the big difference between an NHL player and a European player when you go over there is that you have a lot of time to travel. You get a lot of breaks. So it's really a great experience for the family, as, when you're in the NHL, really, like, during the season, there's barely any family time because it's go, go, go nonstop. So we get to create a lot of relationships, in Europe, and, I'll try to keep them alive because it's always nice to go out there and visit.
Yeah, man, I think that's overlooked about you guys when you're in the NHL, that it really is a job. As much as it might be the best job in the world, it still is. You guys are playing, 5 times a week, traveling all over the state. So you don't, like you said, you don't have time to really talk to anybody besides the boys in the room.
Yeah, exactly. Boys in the room, and then you see your kids, here and there. And any day off you have, obviously, you try to stay home. So you don't really have time to, connect with other people in the community as much as you'd like.
Were you a father early on in your career?
No, I actually, my son was born just when I left the league in 04. So in 05, he was born in the summer of 04 during the lockout.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. So
now, and also when you're overseas there, I think that's probably nice, for some of the guys that go after, an NHL career. Just like you said, the pace. And when you're traveling over there, you're going not from, state to state, but from literally country to country. So the experiences you guys are probably, drinking in are just, once in a lifetime.
Oh, it absolutely is. And again, it's something about, so for me, it was awesome because it was the first year I went was during the lockout. I went to Sweden, and it was my first time going to Sweden ever. And I remember I went by myself. My wife stayed home with my stepdaughter and my son. And I remember going over there and being like, wow, this could be pretty challenging to have the whole family there. But, I talked to a few of what they call imports over there. So basically it's North Americans are playing overseas, and realized that it was definitely feasible. And, if you can find the right team, the right situation, it works out. And, my wife was definitely open to it. It was not always easy, but it's an experience that, she wouldn't take, if she had to do it over again, she definitely would.
For sure. Now, you were still chucking nucks over there. How are the tilts in those leagues compared to when you're over here in the NHL having to fight, Jeff Odgers and Scott Parker and Stu Grimson? I mean, when you were fighting in the early 2000s and then in juniors, they were the monsters of the monsters, including yourself.
Yeah, it was definitely a different. So the European game, and that's another thing. I really struggled during after the lockout to get a job because a lot of North American players went over during the lockout, and the ice is much larger there. It's not as physical as a game, so it's very intense as far as the skating. And,
right.
You know, the NHL, you know, pre-lockouts was not the NHL that we see today where, you know, you're looking at those players now and they're basically figure skaters, right? They can skate. They can move really well from first line to fourth line. And for myself, although I was a really good skater for my size, because of my stats, they're like, well, this guy's just like some kind of enforcer or something. Although I didn't fight that much, they're like, well, we don't know if you can play in Europe. So my first year, I remember it was really hard for me to get a contract. And then once I got there and they realized I could skate, they're like, oh, okay. Then I really started getting way more money. But my first year was like, I remember telling my wife, I'm like, gosh, I don't even know if it's worth it to go, but it definitely was.
Yeah. Well, that was always, you know, in the scouting reports and everything about you is, you know, for a big dude, you know, 6'3", 6'4", you know, 230 pounds, you really could and always have been able to skate.
Yes. And again, it's something that it's kind of funny. I was looking at, I want to say it was a Jeff Skinner video that, you know, he did figure skating starting hockey. That's how I started. So,
oh, really?
My parents, being both being Haitian, their background, you know, they didn't know any better. So when I was growing up, my dad was really busy working at a clinic, and my mom, which was a nurse. So my dad asked my mom to put me in skating lessons, you know, meaning hockey, because he realized that was the big sport there. So all my dad knew was soccer. So my mom went in, put me in skating, and about halfway through a year, around Christmas, we had, like, a recital. And my dad went over, and he's like, so where's this gear? And then he got there, and there I was in, you know, tight pants and skating around doing pirouettes, and he's like, he basically, I guess, you never told me that story until later, but he's like, yeah, I basically lost on your mom. Like, dude, like, this is not what I was talking about.
Oh, that is rich. That's hilarious.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, you know, every single year I played all the way through junior and even the NHL was always like the fastest or at least the second fastest guy on my team. So it was something that really, that was an awkward thing that was not very typical back then. But now as you're looking at all the youth program, they, you know, they're so much more focused just on the skating than there used to be.
Yeah. You know, you speak of your Haitian background. I had your cousin on a couple weeks ago, the great George LaRocque. Did you get to?
Yes.
Were you around him a lot younger? You and him and Jules.
When we're younger, we saw each other, like especially like Christmas parties and stuff like that. We weren't like really that close because he lived like way south. Like he was in a town called Tracy, and then he moved to Montreal later. I was in like on the North Shore, which is like it's a suburb called Laval, but it's like a million people because it's Montreal, obviously.
Right.
So we played against each other every second year because he was like a year older than I was. But it was not something that, like, you know, we grew up like, you know, playing together and stuff like that. Until we got to junior, probably around Bantam, junior is really when we got really close, him and I.
That's got to be, you know, pretty remarkable for your guys' family to have, you know, you two guys play in the NHL, and then Jules, you know, be in the Quebec Major Junior League and do quite well. I think, you know, when your parents probably look back at, you know, making the decision to immigrate to Canada, they probably have to, you know, probably was scary at the time, but looking back now, they're probably, you know, they made the right decision.
Yeah, it was. And I think, you know, for themselves, you know, so for my parents, it was actually kind of funny because, they met in Montreal, so there's a huge there's a huge population of Haitian that go to, you know, it's always Montreal because of the French background, and then a lot of them go to New York and Boston and Miami, obviously. So depending, but I would say those are probably the four biggest cities that Haitian, you know, typically get attracted to. And Montreal, the only reason for it is because that's the only one that there's a large French-speaking population, which is basically what my parents spoke, you know, growing up. So they did meet in Montreal. And again, it was one of these things where my dad was a big soccer guy. So I grew up playing soccer. So did George. You know, hockey was just something that, you know, was introduced both to our parents and ourselves, you know, when we were in Montreal. So it was not like, oh, they immigrated to give their kids a better chance. They, you know, we weren't born yet. We were all born in Montreal.
Right. Now, pardon my ignorance, but is Haiti just a French-speaking country?
So technically, the main language is Creole, but, you know, so,
okay.
You know, it's a, you know, the education level is not the best there, but everybody has some kind of education. Obviously, French is the main language because that's what they teach. And then Creole is kind of like a, you know, it is technically the main language, but all businesses, et cetera, that's all done. It's all conducted in French.
There's probably a lot of English there now because of all the missions that go down there, right?
Correct. And, okay. You know, again, there's more and more, you know, I think the English language is pretty much vital now, even in Montreal. Now everything is bilingual, as is, you know, growing up, you could get away with French, no problem. I didn't pick up English probably, gosh, I remember after I got drafted, I dropped college to take like intensive English lessons.
Oh, really?
Before I went to Buffalo because, yeah, my English was pretty much zero.
Oh, wow. So you were, you know, every bit of like 18, 19 years old before you started learning English?
Yeah, wow. I think it was my 19-year-old, yeah.
That's impressive.
Before I turned pro is when I really start taking English.
Man, that's impressive to pick it up, and I mean, just kill it. That's remarkable.
Yeah.
And in Montreal, since there's so many Haitian immigrants, is the culture pretty strong there? Is it basically, you know, your parents were quite comfortable there?
Yes, it was. And again, it's so, you know, over... In Montreal, I would say typically if you see like, you know, a black guy or African-American, whatever you want to call it, like in Montreal, I would say like 95% chance he's Haitian. So it's kind of funny. And it's a very close community. And actually, funny enough, like when I go to, you know, like I like to travel a lot and mm-hmm. I was in Miami this summer. And, you know, a lot of times just by looking at the guy and certain things they do, I can pick up right away that they're Haitian. I'll start speaking Creole to them. And that happened to me in Miami this year. And then actually when I was in France last week, well, 2 weeks ago, our taxi driver, you know, I start speaking and just by his accent, I was like, this guy's Haitian. And he was telling me, he's like, yeah, he's like, my family's in New York, but I met a girl from France and now he lives there. So it's a very close community wherever you are in the world. It's kind of cool.
Yeah, man, that's awesome. So you're growing up in Montreal, you know, playing, and like you said, it's a very diverse up there, but I'm sure you had, you know, some issues with racism going in there. Is there certain weird racism, like, oh, not only are you black, but you're Haitian? Because I know that, like, even in parts of Columbus with the Somalians, people are super weird with them, like, oh, they're black and they're Somali. It gets, like, super weird how people decide to hate, like, a certain thing.
Right. You know, honestly, the thing with, you know, Quebec in general, and I think it's like that pretty much throughout the country, like Canada or U.S., the more remote and uncommon of a place you live in,
yeah,
the more uncomfortable it would be as a minority. So, like, best example, George, who lived, like, in Tracy or whatever it was growing up, it was pretty hard for him and his family until they moved to Montreal, where, right. Like, you know, the Asian population is so big that it's very common. So it's kind of like, you know, I don't know, like in the States, if you go to a really like down south in some little town, then you're like, oh crap. Like, you're like, this is not comfortable. I wouldn't say in Montreal, yeah, there were a few incidents that happened, but nothing that was like, it was nothing that I was like, holy crap, I yeah. can't handle this situation.
You know, that makes sense, because if you were growing up in a city, everyone just sees everyone. So it's not like you said, when George living in Tracy, you know, he might have been the only black family in the neighborhood. So it would be a little different.
Right. Exactly. And I think racism is going to be there, you know, wherever you are. Unfortunately, it is something like that. But I think it gets definitely amplified if you're in a place where it's not that common.
For sure, man,
if that makes sense.
Yeah, that, I mean, it makes perfect sense. So you go from Montreal to, and I always struggle with this name, the Val d'Or...
Yeah, Flores?
Flores. I can't, yeah. It's the last one, I can never say it, man. Now, is that a lot different than Montreal?
Oh, big time.
Big time.
So yeah, big time difference. I've never been or heard of Val d'Or until, so my
no one
first,
has.
Yeah, my underage year in when I was in Quebec, in Beauport, which was basically Quebec City, in junior at 16, I played on the 16 and under Quebec team, which was, you know, it was like a big tournament that they had around Christmas time. It's kind of like the World Juniors, but for like 16 and unders.
Okay.
And that was basically, they had like Team Quebec, Team Ontario, there was a team for out west, and then there was the United States, and then I want to say Sweden. And we had a tournament. Well, the tournament happened to be in Val-d'Or. And Val-d'Or is cold, like freezing cold. We're talking like minus 40, 50.
Holy smokes.
We had a couple of players that actually froze their ears. Like,
what?
Like legit. Yeah, yeah. Like third-degree burn from frost on their ears because they didn't have a hat on. So that was my first time in Val-d'Or. And I remember we made the finals and played against the U.S. And the rink was completely packed. But, you know, whatever the rink could hold, 4,000 was packed. And it was the biggest experience. And I scored the game-tying goal for us to go to overtime.
My man.
When we won the championship. And I remember like being like, wow, these people love hockey. And then, so I went back to Quebec and finished my junior year and then found out that, you know, I got traded there. I love Quebec City, love my billet family. It was like a huge shock to me. I couldn't believe it. But I went there and honestly, probably like the best 3 years of my life was playing junior in Val-d'Or. The community was awesome. You know, I had a great billet family. You know, it was they're true hockey fans up there back then, that's for sure. And I got to play on, you know, some pretty decent team with some really good players as well, so that always helped.
That's a remarkable system they have up there in Canada. I mean, all the guys that I've spoke to that had billet families speak very highly of them and, you know, are still in contact with their billet parents. I think that's something really unique and I find it fascinating. I mean, and on one hand, I'm like, man, it sucks these kids have to go, but it kind of helps you guys grow up a little bit and experience different things at a young age, especially for the guys like you who end up making it to the AHL and to the NHL, where if all you're doing ever at that age is playing hockey, it kind of gives you some life experience.
Yeah, it is. And it's really, you know, like the billet families have such a big impact on the players that, they, you know, obviously nobody sees it outside yourself as you're growing up and you're like, man, these people really changed my life, you know, like most of, I would say like 99% in a positive way because, yes, you're 16 years old. And I remember my first year junior, I just went to camp. I didn't go to draft because I didn't think I'd get drafted. And, you know, I got drafted and I went to camp just saying, hey, yeah, I'm at camp. I'm going to go play Midget Triple A because I was just playing Bantam the year before. And next thing you know, I had to call my parents to tell them I made the team. And I literally had a suitcase with like, you know, three pair of jeans and, you know, a few shirts because I thought I was going to be there for a couple of days. So, you know, my parents had me enrolled in private school back home. My mom was in shock. Crying. My dad was like, oh, what the heck? All of a sudden, it's like, hey, you're 16 and you're moving out. So, and it was a big shock. And, but again, getting that connection with the billet family and, you know, making your, you know, your parents comfortable with it is a huge thing. And, that's one thing that they have up there that they figured out, right? And I love it.
Yeah.
It's a great experience.
I was really always oblivious to it, you know, living here in the States and not really knowing. Yeah. Because, you know, we knew about college hockey, like, you know, the Buckeyes and everything like that. But
right.
I never really, like, delved too deep into it until the last probably 4 or 5 years. I'm going, oh, wait, these guys have to go away and live with someone else. Like, I find it truly fascinating. And it puts a smile on my face, all the stories that you guys and the players have that, you know, it was such a good experience. I haven't come across one yet, and I hope I never do where it went badly. So
right.
I think Canada really figured that out.
Yeah, and it's something, honestly, so my son, I'm actually at the rink right now because he's got a game here in about 45 minutes, and it's like, that's one of the things that I kind of find, like, and I think it's like that everywhere in the States. So growing up for us as kids, every single tournament we went in, the players would stay with billet families. So it would be like three or four players with a family for the weekend, yeah. right? With a local family. And, you know, they took you around town and showed you a little bit. So you get the experience and really live that before you even got the junior, if you made it. But all my best experience as a kid going to tournament was not staying in hotels, because I never did. It was staying in billets.
Yeah.
And it's kind of one of these things for, like, for my son, I kind of feel like he's missing out on something, because I remember playing street hockeys with a bunch of neighbors from my village that I didn't know. And, you know, after the weekend, they disappear and you'll never see them again, but still stay in touch. And, you know, our kids, you know, they just go to a hotel and they play video games in their room. It's just not the same bond and experience that we had, you know, up in Canada here.
Dude, I think about that now. I have four kids myself, or three, one on the way, and you know, we'll be out in the street and the kids will be playing ball hockey. And I'm like, I want to play, but I'm like, man, I should go in and, like, let these kids just, you know, have at it. And because you're going to be different if there's a dad out there, just the way it is. But I think about that, too. I'm like, man, but I'm like, I want to play, but, like, this is like a life experience. And I think about, like, like you said, the kids that are traveling now, it's all like you say, you stay in the hotel and you see your parents or the whoever parents you're with, and that's it. But it seems like that's the way it is now.
Yeah, it is. It really is. And I think, you know, unfortunately, I don't know if it's because social media
or it's something.
We just are more aware of everything else.
It's yeah.
Like, and now I'm thinking about it, and it's like, okay, as a parent, do I really want my son to go live with a total stranger?
No, you don't. You don't.
In Erie, Pennsylvania, right?
And you like, don't.
Yeah. So, again, it's one of these things where I feel like, unfortunately, the way the world is going, this is going to disappear for a reason. But it's just sad that, you know, our kids are not going to get to experience that unless they go to a Quebec tournament, because I know the Pee Wee Quebec tournament, they still do it that way.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's good. And I think everything's just heightened right now. I think everything will calm down here. It's just that all this technology and everything is so new that you can't help but be worried. And
yeah,
it's just, we all know it's a little weird, but you still can't risk it with that. It's just, you can't do it. With your kids, you can't risk it, man.
Yeah, it's always on the back of your mind.
Absolutely. So and just to backtrack for a moment here, when you're growing up after you're, you know, a figure skating champion, do you get into hockey just because, you know, your dad was there and he's like, well, this is the sport here. Soccer's not the sport here, so you're going to play hockey.
No, so my dad always been, you know, he was a straight up guy, and I would say my relationship with my dad was kind of funny, because it was a relationship of very few words, yet I absolutely, like, idolized them, loved them, and we had a really good relationship. But I don't remember how I ended up starting hockey. I know soccer, it was like, hey, it's summertime, play soccer. And then when I started skating, I was like, you know, I played street hockey all the time, and then I think he just knew that I wanted to play hockey, and that's how I started. I started probably when I was 8 or 9 years old. I started a little late, but that's when I started, and you know, obviously, after my first year, I absolutely loved it. I sucked, I'm sure. Like, it was something where, again, my dad never, ever talked to me about hockey. And never talked to me about soccer. It was literally just the dad. He would take me to the rink, and he'd be like, all right, we're going to the rink, practice, that's it, come after practice. It didn't matter if we won 6-0, if I scored 3 goals, or if I sucked. He never talked about the game. It was just like, we're just talking about life, and that's something that I really admired from him, because I never felt any pressure from him, and, you know, that's kind of how I want to be with my kid, because I've coached high school here for 5 years. I'm not coaching this year, but it's one of these things where I see these kids with so much pressure from those parents about, like,
hey,
you need to tell my kids to do this and that. It's like,
guys, it can backfire.
The kids have fun. Yeah.
It can really backfire.
Yeah, absolutely.
I had a lot of pressure, you know, to go play football in college. And at one point I was just like, you know, this is too much, guys. I just wanted to play the game. Like, it's just, just leave me alone.
I see it all the time. Trust me.
Where did you coach high school at?
Up in New Albany here. So that's, I've been living in New Albany since 2001, and probably, so now that would be 6 years ago, I got approached by somebody from the community saying, hey, we're going to start a hockey team. You know, would you be interested to get involved? And I was like, sure. And you know, I was getting my real estate going at the time, and, you know, I decided to help, and then started as an assistant coach, then I became associate coach for 4 years after, and that's, you know, that's pretty much what we did, but absolutely loved it. And again, for me, it's not something that, yeah, I'm passionate about, you know, coaching. It was really to be able to help young kids, not only on the ice, but also off the ice. And the and that's the thing as a parent, you have to realize the coach, because for me growing up, the impact that a coach can have on a kid,
it's massive.
Not necessarily just as making him a better player, but just a better person, is so big.
It's massive.
And that's the part that I really, really enjoyed.
It's you can't measure it. I mean, I have, you know, because you spend a lot of time with your coaches, you know.
Yeah.
So those guys really mold a lot of young men and, you know, women too. It's remarkable. You can't place a measurement on what they do for young kids, and it's absolutely huge. You know, absolutely. I still see my coaches now out on the streets and say, "Hey, coach," and you know, I think it's weird, like, because I know the dude's name, but I'm like, that's my coach,
yeah,
you know.
Coach. Yeah.
Like, hey, what's up, coach?
That's how it is with a lot of my players. Like, they, you know, they're like, "Hey, coach," and it's so funny because it's one of these things where that bond you create with these families, and because when you have a coach. As a coach, once you have a team like that, it's like they pretty much become family. And it's not only the player, it's the player's brother, sister, parents, sometimes grandparents. And, you know, you run into them and it's almost like, you know, they're like, "Hey, coach." And all of a sudden, you know exactly whose kid it is. Now they're in college. Some of them have jobs. And you're like, it's crazy how much, you know, of an impact you can have on these kids without really, like, knowing it when you sign up to be a coach.
What I thought was weird is, like, you know, you'll hear a term like a toxic locker room, you know, in the NHL. And it's a real thing because I remember in high school, our football team, like, dudes didn't get along and we won, like, 3 games. It wasn't because of talent. It was because nobody cared about one another. So that's right. Another thing, too, a coach can really do is bring that family essence in there. And if there's a tight-knit team, they're hard to beat in crucial moments.
Yes, yes. This generation of kids that we have now is so different.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, it is so different than, you know, I'm 41 years old now. So, you know, you're looking, when I was that age, that means, you know, 50, so that was 25 years ago for me. And the way we were and the way they are now, it's so different. A lot of people don't understand it, but, you know, sometimes I look at John Torella's comments, and he's so right on.
Oh, my God. He's just the best.
Yeah, it's so different. For me, before games, when I see players, like, on the red line talking to each other, I'm like, what the heck?
Dude, it's weird.
I'm like, it's just weird. I'm like, can't we just do that after the game or tomorrow? Like,
well, I want
to play.
And that's something I always enjoyed about your style, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but it seemed like, you know, when you would fight, you would have, you know, your chest out, chin up, and it seems like you were almost chirping while you're fighting, too. And I was like, oh, God, I love that. It reminds me, and I know this is a huge comparison, but, like, when Michael Jordan would play, he was talking to dudes. And
right,
like,
right.
And what separated him, I think, is he wanted to beat you. He didn't want to just win the game. He wanted to beat you. And that's it is not there now. Everybody just wants to be good at hockey. Nobody wants to be Michael Jordan, if that makes sense.
Right. Well, for me, like, as you're talking about fighting, honestly, is like, if I look back at every time I fought, if I didn't fight with fear, I knew I was cooked. And every time I lost a fight, unless I fought Stu Grimson and he's just too big for me, it was literally, if I didn't have fear or emotion where, you know, I could never, and again, like these real enforcers like George and Jody, I don't know how they did it, because for me to just look at someone and say, "Hey, let's fight," I would probably have got my ass whooped every single fight because it's all about adrenaline.
Yeah.
I remember I've never been a fighter in my life. And I remember my very first fight, I was like, I completely destroyed the guy.
Was your first fight in junior?
Yeah, in junior, yeah. And my first pro fight, I destroyed the guy in exhibition, and he actually retired. It was a guy from Toronto, I don't remember. But I guess, like, after that fight, he literally retired. But it was not because I was, like, a good fighter. It was just literally fear. And yeah. When you have fear, you know you can move mountains, right? But if somebody just came to me and be like, hey, dude, let's go, I'd be like, oh, crap. I know they got my ass whooped. Just be, not because he's tough or he's not tough, just because you don't have that emotion and fear going. So that's probably why my face was like that on those fights.
Well, so you kind of thrive off that awe stress and just kind of, well, like, you know, you'd hit somebody. A lot of your fights, like, you'd hit somebody, and then somebody would kind of be like, okay, that was my dude, and you'd answer the bell.
Right, exactly. So,
well, dude, you hid your fear very well, because it looked like you were just daring them to hit you, the way you'd put your chin out there, like, all right, let's go, guys. I got an iron face. Let's go.
Yeah, I've never been much of a technical fighter that would kind of, like, protect himself, because, again, it was one of these things. It's just like a street fight, and I didn't have the never worked on it, nor did I ever want to really become a good technical fighter per se, because to me it was purely emotion, and I was like, oh well, if I can be 50-50, 50% on the fights, I'll be happy, as long as I don't get my ass whooped every time, I'm okay with it.
Well, hey man, you had, I think, 125 fights, and you won over half of them, so you did your job, man. So you get drafted, and you get drafted to Buffalo. So going from Montreal to Buffalo is like, you know, hockey city to hockey city. You have a couple years there with the Sabres, and then in Rochester as well. And then you come to Columbus in the expansion draft, right?
Right before I think the day before the inspection draft is when I got traded over to Buffalo to Columbus.
So you weren't in the expansion draft per se. You got traded to Columbus before they drafted anybody?
Yeah, so remember, kind of like this year with Vegas, how they had like some behind-the-scenes trades.
Yeah.
So certain teams pick another player. So right. Buffalo had okay. Marty Biron and Dominic Hasek, and they didn't want to lose one of them. So I believe that the way they – I think Dwayne Rolson had to get claimed by Minnesota, and then Buffalo Columbus had to pick Jeff Sanderson instead of another player. I don't remember who. And then part of that trade, they sent me, Matt Davidson, and someone else to Columbus. So that was kind of the trade.
So had you ever been to Columbus at that point in your life?
Never heard of it. Been there. Actually, never even heard of Ohio State football, believe it or not, before I came to Columbus.
Well, that makes sense. I mean, there's a few dark ages in there for the Buckeyes. You wouldn't know it now, but yeah, there was some dark times there. But so, and this is really intriguing for me, you know, being an Ohio hockey fan, and you know, remembering, you know, watching you play and like the other guys, and being like, oh, these, you know, I think, and you've spoken on this before. Columbus didn't really know what to do when we had a team to begin. And so that guys like you who would chuck a little bit, and, you know, the style you played, you quickly became a fan favorite in Columbus because of the way you played. Because they could connect to that quickly. They go, oh, look at this guy. He hits people. He fights. We get right. This. We know this.
Right. And it's, you know, if you look at the, you know, our initial group that came in, that's where, you know, Lyle O'Line, big fan favorite. You know, Tyler Wright was like pesky little player, going hard. You know, all these type of guys really, you know, they're typically fan favorite in most cities, especially in blue collar cities. But when it's a new city, Columbus is not necessarily like a Cleveland or a really blue collar city. But I think with the excitement of a new team, they're like, hey, this guy, he likes to throw hits, it makes noise. I love him, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It's like, that's where the popularity really came from, I think.
Yeah. Now, what was that initial shock going from two hockey cities to Columbus, which is not?
It was actually pleasant. You know, it was kind of pleasant because as a player, it's always nice to be not necessarily, you know, like, example, in Montreal, you cannot leave your driveway or go to the store, you know, without being recognized by someone, or Toronto, God forbid, you know, these cities. You know, in Columbus, it was nice because, you know, I remember, like, meeting my next door neighbor, which became one of my best, you know, friends throughout the years. And, you know, he's asking me what I do for a living. I was like, oh, I play hockey. He's like, oh, that's nice. didn't ask any more questions. He couldn't care less. You know, he couldn't care less about, oh, this guy's a, you know, NHL player. And then about like 3 months later, him and I got really close, start riding motorcycles together, golfing and stuff like that. And he's like, so really, what do you do? And I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, well, I don't know. It's like my wife and I, we built right next to you. And we're like, he's got all these nice cars. He's home all the time. You know, that was in the summertime.
Yeah.
Like, at this point, they're like, this guy's like pretty dealing drugs.
Yeah, this guy's right? A drug dealer for sure.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm like, no, man. I'm like, that's my off season. I'm just chilling because I always spent my off season in Columbus. I always love to spend my off season wherever I played.
Oh, cool.
And he was like, really? And I was like, yeah. He's like, you should come to a game one time. And honestly, he's like, he ended up coming to one game this whole time because he couldn't care less who I was. He really liked me for who I was. So, and I created a lot of really nice relationships in Central Ohio, not because of like, hey, he's a hockey player, play for Blue Jackets. I'm sure it helps here and there, but like, it's really like the people in Central Ohio are so genuine that I actually like the fact that, you know, the Columbus Blue Jacket wasn't that huge of a deal because as a person and, you know, for well, I didn't have a family at the time, but like as a person, it just feels better for yourself.
Yeah. And then
unless you're looking for recognition, then you're in the wrong spot.
And Jody Shelley's probably thinking that same thing until I ruined it for him and start creeping him out. Well, and what's has to be, you know, super fun for you is you have literally watched Columbus and Central Ohio hockey grow, you know, kind of take a dive there for a little bit when the Blue Jackets, you know, never really picked up and then pick back up again.
Yes.
So, I mean, you've seen the whole peaks and valleys of Ohio hockey, really.
Yeah, I saw from the beginning when it was exciting and didn't matter what the score was, people were still coming.
Yep.
To the honeymoon is over.
Yeah.
Show me something.
Nash leaves.
And then it went really bad. Yeah, exactly. And then Nash leaves. And then, you know, Torts gets here and then turns the team around with Mr. Davidson and Yarmo. So that's, you know, I would say if I were to pick the brightest moment in Columbus hockey history, I would say probably year one, year two,
uh-huh.
And then the past 3 years, definitely.
I would agree 100%, yeah. Man. I think in between there, you know, like 05 and 06, I think people in Ohio forgot there was a team there for whatever reason.
Well, the lockout happened at a bad spot.
Sure did.
The lockout killed it, especially for a newer team like Columbus. And people obviously went a year without hockey and are like, man, we can live without this. So I'm like, and then the team comes back and struggles terribly for years and years. And that frustration. And again, the expectations in Central Ohio for pro teams are pretty high because, you know, you have the Buckeyes, who's the, you know, number one team in town. And, you know,
especially at that time,
year, right? You go 12-1 and they want to fire everyone.
Oh, it's insane.
One game.
It's insane.
So, it's pretty hard to live up to that kind of, you know, standard.
Well, that's what I always felt bad for the Blue Jackets is that, especially the way college football is, if you lose one game, you're pretty much shit out of luck.
Right.
And, so that expectation is nuts, but I think, and I've heard this in interviews with you before, that the knowledge and the understanding of the game now that an Ohio hockey fan has is 10,000 times bigger than it was in the year 2000. I mean, now they kind of understand, like, but they're still getting a little antsy, like, you know. And when you don't win playoff series, it's like, okay, are we just going to keep winning and make it to the playoffs and then just, you know, shit the bed? Or what are we going to do here, guys? They expect winners. They expect winners.
They expect winners. They, you know, they're at a point where they don't get excited about, hey, we finished first in the Metro or we made the playoff. Now they want to see that next step. And realistically, I think that next step is getting to a conference championship, right?
I think so.
If they can win the East and, you know, make it to Stanley Cup final, I think people are, you know, are going to get excited.
Yeah, I think so. It's winning fixes everything, always.
Winning fixes everything. It's just the matchups, those first round matchups for the Jackets have not been easy, right?
No, what the hell, dude? We get Detroit the first time, then Pittsburgh twice, then the Capitals. You go 2-0 on the Capitals and then lose. I'm just like, oh my God, I'm going to pull my hair out.
Exactly. So it's kind of like a bad luck of the draw. You know, the Metro was really crappy, but then everybody was crappy. Then we joined it, and then now you look at the Metro. Now it's like arguably the best, you know, division in hockey. If you look at the talent pool that's in there and the teams and their history in the past 5 years, that's probably the worst division to be in. But guess what? That's how you get better, right?
Exactly. So, you have to play up to the competition.
Exactly.
Now, when you're in a locker room, you know, early on in the career, and I know you had the aforementioned Jody Shelley and juniors, is that weird to be a teammate with somebody you fought?
It is. You know, I don't know if I fought Jody ever, to be honest with you, but I've played with guys that I fought before, and it's really something that you don't even talk about, you know, as a player when you get in that locker room, because
you both know.
Like, yeah, you both know, hey, you know, you slashed me, so yeah, I jumped you and I, you know, knocked your tooth out. It is what it is, and, you know, we're over it. And a lot of times you'll see guys, even after a game, they'll go, you know, they'll get in a fight, and after a game, they'll just go and go have dinner together as a group because, you know, they're with teammates, et cetera. And I've never seen, well, personally anyway, I've never seen animosity where two guys that fought, you know, on the ice, you know, meet in the hallway after and want to go at each other. It's really something that, and again, a lot of those guys, NHL fighters or like pretty much any NHL players, most of them, because of their background, honestly, they're such nice people off the ice and humble people that it's not the type of guys that you're going to see going into a nightclub and start punching people because they stared at their girlfriend the wrong way or something like that.
Right.
You rarely hear of NHL players, you know, getting in trouble off the ice just because of the background and really I don't want to say the other sports are like they're not working as hard to get where they got, but it just, there's something about hockey about like, everything that you have to go through to make it really to the top that you're, I would say 99% of the players are so grateful to be in the place that they are that they wouldn't do anything to jeopardize it. And the other thing is, it's just not in them to be like that.
Yeah.
So,
I mean,
it's weird.
Especially guys who love hockey so much that they'll fight for it and get in. And
right.
I mean, obviously everybody wants to be Wayne Gretzky, but there was a position at the time you played and that you could kind of fight your way into the NHL. And I'm not saying that's how you did. I'm saying there are certain players that did that.
Right.
And it's weird that, you know, and you know, we talked about social media earlier that it can be a negative thing, but it can also be a huge positive thing for guys, you know, that were enforcers, because I always thought they were just hard-ass monsters. But you start to see what they post about and you talk to them and you're like, oh, these guys are the best guys on the planet.
Yeah, they are. And, you know, most of the time, those enforcers are the people that do the most in the community as far as, like, kid stuff, hospital visits. And it's just because, it's not because they have to, it's because they really, you know, want to. And, but, you know, as you're talking about the fighting, it's something that it's kind of like you end up with that role out of nowhere. I've never been a fighter. And my first year pro, we were so bad in Rochester. And, you know, I've always been a physical player. I always loved to hit people. Well, you know, in junior, you hit people. Yeah, once in a while, somebody will challenge you. In the pros, every time you hit somebody, somebody was coming after you. My first year pro, I think I had 19 or 21 major, which, like, I've never fought more than three times in a year before that year. And I remember Larry Carrier, who was one of the scouts for Buffalo, came down to Rochester halfway through the year. He's like, dude, what are you doing? And I'm like, what do you mean? And he's like, well, you know, you're just fighting. This is not what we drafted you for. But, you know, to me, my agent always told me, he's like, well, you need to be on the scorecard. And I was like, I know I'm not going to score a bunch of goals as a defenseman. So I'm like, my way to be on the lineup and on the scorecards was like, all right, I got to get a 2-minute cross check. I gotta do something. And I was like, the only way not to really hurt the team is if I hit somebody really hard and somebody wants to fight, then I'll get pissed off and I'll get a 5 and I'll be on the score sheet. So to me, that was my way to make it to the NHL. And it's not because a coach said, hey, you need to do that. It was just to me, I knew that's what was going to set me apart, because skill-wise, I think everybody, you know, on the team was pretty much equal, and I just had to do something to separate myself.
So how does that
work? That's what it took.
Yeah, well, how did that work? He comes down and says, this isn't what we drafted for. You put up 211 PIMs that first year in Rochester, then what, the second year, still 90. But was that a conscious effort to kind of lower that because the Buffalo coach said, hey, this isn't what we're scouting for?
Yeah, it was it was a little bit of a mix of things, where my second year, I think I've earned the respect of a lot of veterans.
That's
because
huge.
You come in as a 20-year-old rookie, and you know they're like, dude, you think you can start hitting people around here? You have to respond. I remember there was a guy that played with George, Dennis Bonvie.
Bonvie is a monster.
Oh my God, he'd come. I think I fought Bonvie my rookie year probably 5-6 times, because we played against Hamilton all the time.
Dude. My hat is off to you. I wouldn't even want to sit in a room with that guy.
And Dennis, George would tell Dennis, don't fight him. He's my cousin. He's like, I got to do what I got to do, George. And every time George would be like, dude, Dennis is going to come after you. And, you know, we fought. And then I would say about halfway through that year, Dennis finally is like, he looked at me on the red line and he's like, kid, you've earned my respect. And I was like, oh my gosh, finally I'm done. Never fought him again, ever, right? It was one of these things where you kind of, it was like almost like, initiation/bullying, where it's like you got to earn your stripes, and then once you earn their respect, you know, they leave you alone, right? Unless you go completely out of line, which I was never, you know, that type of player anyway. So, but it was one of these things, every time we play against Hamilton, I'm like, oh, crap, you know, Bonvie again.
Yeah.
Or whoever team we played, I knew somebody somehow you would somewhat come after me in some way. And I was not the toughest guy on my team, because we had Vandermeer on our team. We had Ramon Endor, remember? Nigerian Nightmare was on our team.
Oh, yeah.
We had, like, Dean Melanson was on our team. We had a tough team. But somehow the rookie had to respond.
Yeah, it might have been part of that being a rookie job, huh?
Exactly.
Well, that's crazy. I actually had a question on here, you know, who was a guy you fought that kind of slides under the radar a little bit. And I always think Dennis Bonvie gets, when people think of some of the greatest fighters, I think he gets shafted out of that position a lot of times. I think he was really just a monster on the ice.
Yeah, he was, I'm not going to lie, my first year playing against him, I'm like, man, this guy's an idiot. I hate his gut. And then I realized he was just doing his job, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, I got to know him off the ice. Man, what a great guy he is, right?
Well, that's good to hear.
What's that?
I said that's good to hear.
Yeah. Oh, he absolutely, like, you know, the nicest guy. But when, you know, you're a rookie, you don't know any better, and, you know, it's just like, this guy won't leave me alone. You're like, man, I hate this guy. He must be an idiot. But he really was a really, really nice guy. And I would say most of those enforcers, they're just doing their job. And,
yeah.
You know, sometimes it's frustrating, but I've never really met somebody that's like, this guy's like legitimately like an idiot and something is wrong with him. They're all just doing their job and they're pursuing a dream, right?
Yeah.
So it's, Dennis, yes, absolutely, you know, a legend. And again, that's why he's been a fan favorite everywhere he played, just because he was that guy that represented the hard work, dedication, you know, all the way from his rookie year till he retired.
Yeah, can you think of anyone else who you might have fought back in the day that maybe doesn't get that kind of respect, like a Bonvie or a Bialowis, you know? He's huge in the fighting community, but,
right,
you know, there are certain guys that you might have had to tilt with. Is there one that comes to mind where you're like, oh, that guy, you know, he could go?
Oh, gosh. That guy could go. Man, I will say, I forgot his name. He was, oh, my gosh. He played in New Jersey's farm team. He was a little guy. He had a face made of stone. And I'm trying to think of his name. I have a picture of him and I fighting, and the picture is sweet because it's me landing a punch right to his face, but literally, Dodie Wood.
You guys fought in Lowell?
In Rochester.
In Rochester.
Dodie Wood was his name. He was not a big guy. Played with the New Jersey's farm team in Albany back in the days. Probably, honestly, pound for pound, the toughest guy I ever fought.
Really?
Yeah, he looked like nothing, And, you know, I found out later that he was, Native American. And that explained why his face was so strong. I mean, he basically beat my face to death, which, you know, when you look at the tape, it looked like I won the fight. But I'm telling you, the next morning, I was bruised up pretty freaking bad. And he was not a big guy. But he stood in there and took him, and he ripped me a few times. Where I was like, oh, boy, I hope I didn't break it.
Yeah, that would have been 97-98, Dodie Wood.
That's my rookie year.
Yeah, bud. And he has over 300 fights, man.
Yeah. See, and if you say his name to anyone, it's like, who's that? But that guy, man, woo-hoo, tough little guy.
Well, I've never heard of him, so I'm excited to dive into him, man. That's why I wanted to ask you. You guys see so many faces and so many people, you know, can kind of just not make it, and then that's it, man.
Yeah.
Now, and you were part of two of the toughest teams in Columbus Blue Jackets history. 2002, you guys had 64 fighting majors as a team, and 2003 had 75. Is it weird to see them now, how they're, you know, maybe third to the bottom in fights? I know they're winning a lot, but to me, I grew up with a physical Columbus Blue Jackets team, so it's I'm glad they're winning, but it's not as exciting for me, if that makes sense.
Well, here's the funniest thing, right? Can you imagine if I talked to you 15 years ago and I tell you John Torello's team would be one team with the least fighting majors in the league? You'd be like, you're crazy, right?
He's probably leading the team in fighting majors this year.
Yeah, and but again, the game has changed so much.
He's so smart.
Right? He is so smart, and that's what makes him successful. Because everybody's like, everybody gave him 2 years. Like, his message is not going to go, and then after 2 years, people are going to be sick of him. But the 180 that he did to adapt to this new generation is impressive.
He made him a real hockey team.
He made them a real hockey team, and he completely changed his coaching style.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I can see a little bit of the old torts wanting to come out sometimes when you hear him make comments to the media about, like, hey, I just want some old school hits.
Yeah.
Some guys to get pissed off and stuff like that. But he gets it that it's just not. You know, that type of player just is not there anymore, because that's not the era they grew up in. The only guy that's left like that would be probably a little bit Nick Foligno, who doesn't mind dropping him, and, you know, Brandon Dubinsky. But all the other guys are from that new wave, right?
Yeah.
You look at a guy like Josh Anderson where you're like, dude.
Oh, my God. You know, he could destroy it. He just doesn't.
I mean, Josh Anderson is like Tom Wilson Jr. if you want.
Oh,
he's a destroy guy. But, right, Tom Wilson somehow got the old school mentality.
Yeah.
Right?
Josh doesn't have it.
Right. To me, I look at Tom Wilson and I'm like, oh, my gosh, dude, I want you on my team today.
Yeah, 100%. Right? Ryan Reeves, Tom Wilson.
Everybody says, oh, no, Tom Wilson's an idiot. I'm like, as a coach, man, if John Torella had Tom Wilson on his team, oh, my gosh, he'd be like in Washington first line, PK, you'd be on the ice playing 25 minutes.
They'd be steak dinners at night, you know.
Yeah, he'd be captain and everything, right?
Oh, yeah.
But that type of player with that attitude doesn't really exist anymore. And that's what, you know, obviously in D.C. they hit the jackpot with him if they can keep him off the penalty, you know, if they can keep him off the suspensions.
Yeah.
Because, first of all, he produces offensively, which is incredible, right?
He's huge.
16 points in 14 games.
He's huge.
Like that.
He's huge.
And you can play on your first line, nobody's going to mess up with your other players because, dude, it's not like he's on a fourth line to send him out to send a message.
No.
He's there with Ovi all the time.
He's got the green light, dude.
Exactly. So that's the perfect dream player right down the team.
Well, and I thought, you know, Josh Anderson in his first few years, I was like, oh, my God, it's a baby Tom Wilson. We got him. And he kind of was that way, and he kind of tilted away with it, and then he didn't sign. And I think something happened to him mentally when he kind of held out last year and joined the team later. And you'll see flashes of it every now and again. You're like, oh, my God, there he is. And I hope something just – but like you said, and I think Tortorello, I mean, at the end of the day, he's a winner. He knows what it takes to win in the league, so he's going to do that. And I think he gets his frustration out in the interviews, and he's going to say that stuff. But when it comes down to coaching, he knows how he has to coach to get the team to win.
Exactly. And he knows Josh is there in case, you know, like they say, in case shit happens.
Dude, Josh dropped with Zdeno. That's a fucking 7-footer.
Yeah, and Josh is tough. Trust me, he's really, really tough. But I don't think it's not in him. I think he's just smart.
Yeah,
he might be too smart for his own good. He's like, because sometimes I see him in game and I'm like, oh, he's gonna light this guy up, and he kind of lays up because he knows the new NHL is not like the old one, right?
Yeah. Now,
if you have the puck, it doesn't matter if you have the puck or not. If I don't see you coming to hit me, it's a penalty coming, right?
And he can fight too. I mean, he's really good at it.
Oh yeah. He is. He's talented. I mean, I think he's got like 10 or 12 goals already this year. So
yeah, he's on my fantasy team. Player. Thank you, Josh.
Yeah, he's a good player. He's physical, and he's got that edge to him. And, you know, Boone Jenner's the same way.
Yeah, and like you said, Dubinsky's one of the few dudes that doesn't wear a visor still. Or he might wear one this year, actually. I think he finally clipped one on.
Yeah, I think after
he broke his orbital.
He ended up putting one, yeah.
Yeah. So do you have a pretty tight relationship with the boys still?
So the current players, no. I still have, obviously I'm in touch with Jody and then, some of the alumni, because now more and more players are, staying back in town. So like Andrew Castle, Freddie Modine, I hang out with these guys here, especially obviously in the off season, because in the winter our kids are all playing hockey left and right. But,
do you know Jared Bull?
The players on the team, not really. What's that?
Do you know Jared Bull?
Yeah, I know Jared, yeah. Absolutely. I think I'll see him tonight at the game.
Oh, dude, Tommy's my favorite player ever.
Will do.
Now, what kept you in Ohio?
What kept me in Ohio? So, after Columbus, went to, D.C. and Atlanta, and then we ended up starting to go to Europe. And my stepdaughter went to school in Columbus, and... obviously in Europe when we're there. And to me, looking at everything, I was like, okay, do I go back to Montreal? My wife's from the Cleveland area. So.
Oh, hell yeah. She's awesome then.
Yeah. So the kids grew up, in Central Ohio, and I wasn't, necessarily attracted to D.C. or Atlanta, and I really, really like Columbus. And, the quality of life, there's nothing like spectacular about Columbus,
right.
But there's nothing bad.
Right.
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 So to me, I look at like Atlanta, right? It was like, oh, yeah, big city. I hate traffic. It's too
long.
Right.
Atlanta traffic is one of the worst cities for traffic in the world. Right. It has to be.
DC, cost of life is ridiculous.
Insane.
Traffic again.
Yep. Oh, yeah. Their traffic's up there, too.
Right. Montreal, which is where I'm from. God, I love that city. But yeah, I just like to visit now. It's just like New York. I can't deal with all this traffic.
Is Montreal a big, is it like a huge, like a New York City?
It's basically like a New York City, growing up, for me, going to school, it was an hour and 25 minute drive to go to school because of traffic.
Oh my God.
It's 15 minutes.
Why?
It was just the way it was.
Dude, that's insane.
It's insane. And I hate it. So sometime when I catch myself on 71 and... there's a little hold up, and I'm 5 minutes late. I just tell myself, dude, just remember
right.
Who you grew up with. Right. Like, just be grateful, right?
My oldest son lived in Columbus with his mom for a couple years, so I would have to drive down there, and it'd be like 5 o'clock, and I'd get in there and be stuck for 15 minutes. I'm like, I could be driving to Cleveland. It could be worse. It could,
it could be so much worse. So yeah, I love Columbus, and then I love golf now. So there's golf courses everywhere.
Dude, I'm getting into golf. Is it something from like getting older that you just get into? You think?
Unfortunately, I think it is.
I think it's there's something like, because it's super challenging.
Super challenging, and it's such it's obviously getting some fresh air.
I'm not awesome. Going to get hurt.
You're not going to get hurt. You can have a few pops if you want.
Yeah, I have a few.
There you go. I mean, it's just, I think it's such a challenging sport because you're just playing against yourself all the time. Yeah, you play with other people, but you're really playing against yourself, not against other people. And it's a new kind of competition for me, but I'm so competitive that, I just keep going and going nonstop.
Are you still chirping out there on the links?
Oh, yeah. All
the time. Have you been over to Top Golf yet?
I have not.
Dude,
have not.
It looks so much fun.
Yeah, I know. It does look like fun. I'm definitely going to have to make my way there, but I haven't been there yet.
I couldn't believe they opened it up in the winter. It seemed like a weird time to open it.
Yeah, it's odd, but Yeah, I guess it was their planning was a little off, but I know that, you know, that place is packed all the time still. So
absolutely, man. Yeah. Now, you have something. You're the hockey director of Belfry Hockey. What is that?
Belfry Hockey. So Daryl Belfry, he's a skill instructor with the Toronto Maple Leafs. He's basically a private instructor. He started working with like Sidney Crosby, Nate MacKinnon, and these guys. So
couple good guys.
Oh yeah, he's got a lot of, you know, if you go in on his website and see who he works with, like, you know, actually Austin Matthews is probably his protege. Like, he started with Austin since he's a kid.
Really?
So yeah. So now, because of Austin, I think he works with Toronto, with the Marlies and the Maple Leafs. So he has a program that he used to have down in Florida that he terminated, and we took it over here in Columbus.
Good.
And it's basically a skill development program where we take kids anywhere from squirts to Bantams and show them how to play hockey, but without any really structure.
Boys and girls?
Boys and girls, correct. And we basically work, emphasis is really on practices. So we practice at least four times for every one game.
Oh, wow.
So, because obviously that's where you get the most valuable time. And we don't work on breakouts, power plays, penalty killings. It's literally all about skill development. So it's basically like an all-year academy type thing that we do. It's a different way to develop players. And, it's been great because we don't have tryouts. You know, it's just like
that's enrollment, nice.
And we have a very competitive team from it.
Well, that's huge for Ohio hockey, especially is the initiatives out there to nobody's getting cut. Everyone, because hockey's not big here. It just isn't. And it's way bigger than it ever has been. But, I mean, that's amazing that you guys and players like yourself and, you know, other players from the Blue Jackets who have stayed in that area have really changed the culture of Ohio. So I thank you guys for that. And that's massive to have kids that can just come down and work out. I mean, I know my nephew's playing hockey. My daughters are going to learn to skate here this winter. So, it's going to be guys like you, you know, when they look back at it, my daughter's going to go, oh, we play because, you know, Jean-Luc, it's really cool.
Right. Yeah, and again, it's something that, especially as coaches at any level, unless you're, you know, in the juniors or college hockey, it's just the sport itself, having that love for the sport and just what it brings to kids. Not, you know, my goal is not to develop players to get them to the NHL. If they were to get there,
yeah,
so be it. I'm happy. It's just really introduce them to the sport. And, you know, down the line, you know, because I play men's league. I play goalie.
Goalie, baby. I was going to say, you're a goalie now.
That's right. And it's like for me to see like these old 40-year-old out there having fun, laughing, having a couple beer, you know, after the game, just from the sport, you know, like that they love. And a lot of them, believe it or not, didn't pick up hockey until the Blue Jackets came in town.
So absolutely,
for me to
man.
See that explosion is awesome.
And yeah.
For me, I just want these kids to have that for the rest of their life.
Oh, yeah, I mean, you saved my life. I was a Maple Leaf fan until you guys came around. I just have a couple more for you. I know you said your son's playing tonight, and then I'll get you on your way here. And again, not only do I thank you for, you know, making me not a Maple Leaf fan and bringing, you know, Columbus hockey around and being on the show, dude, I really appreciate it. I wanted to talk to you about this, the two games at once that I saw you might have invented, where you're setting the tablet in a lady's hood in front of you, watching a game while you're watching a game.
Yes. So that was actually last weekend.
I love
it. For the Big Ten Championship, my son had a game over at OSU, at the OSU rink, and my son's team was getting blown up, so I didn't have much interest in whatever was going on out there, so my wife was sitting in front of me, and we grabbed the phone and put the game on, and I was like, hey, just don't tell anyone. We can act like we're actually watching something worth watching. So we just put the game in her hood, and, you know, all the players out there thought I was watching the game, but little did they know I was watching a real good game.
Dude, it's absolutely brilliant. I think about it now, I'm like, man, some of these little girls' games, I'm probably going to tune out maybe a couple of them. So I'm just going to start adapting that for sure.
That's right. Just make sure you don't hold the device, because then you're that. That's not interesting.
Oh, no, you can't do that. And I wanted to touch back. You know, you talk about kids and the life lessons that they learn playing. I know, and apologize to my brother, but his son was an asshole. And he was. And me and my nephew, he's very young. He's only like 5, but him and I would just butt heads. And ever since he started playing hockey, man, he's a good, disciplined young man. He's awesome. He's loving hockey. He thinks about it all the time. And he realized that he's kind of being a little dick. And that sports can help so much. So if you're listening and you have kids and they're sitting around, not just put them in a sport. I don't care if it's hockey or jujitsu or baseball, it will help. I guarantee it.
Absolutely. It's a big structure thing for kids.
Yeah, and kids love structure.
Yes. They won't admit it, but they love it.
Yeah, they won't admit it. You're right, but they absolutely love it. What do you notice about the game differently playing as a goalie now?
As a goalie, I'm always looking for new challenges in life, right? Whether it's golf, you know, with hockey, for me, it was like, I just want to do something different.
Well, what are you going to do? Go out there in men's league and just kill everybody and play defense? Like, come on.
No, I actually play left wing in men's league when I play forward. That's a new challenge, too. But for me to be a goalie, I've always loved goalie equipment. Always loved goalie equipment.
Me too, man.
When I played in Germany and in the DEL, actually, I almost played a goal in game. I almost played a game in goal.
Really?
I was captain of my team, and we were playing on the road. And true story, listen to that as well. So we're playing on the road, and within the first 2 minutes of the game, our goalie gets hurt. So we put the backup, right?
Yeah.
Halfway through the first period, we're on a 5-on-3, and our second goalie blows his groin.
What?
So, I was like, the coach is like, well, we don't have a goalie. What are we supposed to do? The ref's like, well, you have 10 minutes to find a goalie. So, I look at the coach, and I was like, hey, I'm like, you know, here and there in practice, I'd mess around when the coach wasn't looking for optional morning skates, and I'd go in net with the goalie equipment, you know, making sure guys didn't shoot too hard on me and stuff. So I told the coach, I'm like, hey, I'll go in net. He's like, you will? I'm like, yeah, I don't care. I'm like, that'll be awesome. So I run in the locker room. Will, I put the whole equipment on, everything, and I'm ready. The trainer's taping
my mind. You have the backup goalie on, gear on?
The first goalie that got hurt.
Oh, my God.
So I put all his gear on because he was still in the locker. You know, he was on the training table, and he's helping me. So I'm ready to go. I'm in the hallway, ready to go in. And the team owner comes down. He's like, dude, you're not going in that. He's
what's wrong with you?
I'm paying you way too much money to go get hurt out there. He's like, you're not. And I was like, you got to be kidding me. So we end up canceling the game. So we forfeited the game. And it was like a mess. But I was almost going to play an actual game that mattered, pro. That would have been awesome.
Dude, I was like, what the hell? Why are we forfeit? I'm like, how much am I going to get hurt playing goalie?
Well, the problem was, it's not like we're in the third period with 10 minutes to go. It was first period.
Right.
We still had like 2.5 periods to play. And I would have started on a 5-on-3. I would have got lit up. But I already had my celebration picked out if I made a save.
Oh, dude, what was it?
That was awesome. Was that? Oh, what? I had a little dance that I talked to one of my defensemen about doing.
Do you do it in men's league now?
No, I'm not that flashy. I do have a lot of fun, though, I'll tell you that.
That's awesome, man. And thanks again, dude, for coming on. And just if you have anything to plug, you know, hit the Biscuit Babies up now. You know, your Twitter, your Instagram, and all that good stuff.
Well, I'll tell you guys, I'm a real estate agent in the Columbus area now. And I just, last week, I reached my $15 million sale for the year, so it's been a super cool year this year.
Congratulations, man.
I want to sell $20 million next year, so if any of you guys out there listening need some help with real estate, shoot me an email, text, whatever. I'm easy to find.
Hell yeah, man. And they can find you at, what, just Jean-Luc Grand-Pierre on Instagram and Twitter,
yeah,
right?
They can email me at jlgp@therainsgroup, and that's RAINESgroup.com, or they can Google it and they'll find me. It's super easy.
Jean-Luc, thank you so much, man. This has been an absolute pleasure, and again, thank you for all you've done for Ohio hockey, and thanks for being on the show, man.
All right, brother. If you're ever in Columbus this summer and want to go play a little round of golf, let me know. I'd love to hook up.
Dude, let's do it.
All right, man.
All right, party on.
All right, bye.
Later. Hey, well, if you didn't like that interview, you can go fuck yourself. Thanks for listening, guys. I appreciate it. Big news on the horizon. Very big news. Fourth Line Voice and myself might have some very big news on the horizon. Keep your ears and eyes out. It's huge. You guys are going to freak out. It's going to be awesome. Just waiting for the final thing so we can announce it. Go rate and review us, iTunes, whatever, wherever you listen to it. Please just leave a rate and a review. It takes 10 seconds. Obviously, it's 5 stars, the greatest podcast of all time. I don't need to keep explaining it, but I'm going to. It really helps how the show gets searched. If people search hockey, we'll show up the more reviews we have. So please tell a friend, rate and review us, spread the word. This is how this show grows. I appreciate you guys. I love you guys. Have a safe and happy weekend. It's not the holidays yet. It's only the 8th. Party on.